we bless your name, for you have brought us to your own industry to shape us, to transform us, to renew us, to make us better Christians and better workers in your kingdom. Lord, we bless your name for what you have been teaching us and what you have been revealing unto us. We pray you be glorified in Jesus' name. Lord, we come to a special aspect of the meeting. Lord, we pray again, you will speak unto every one of us. The letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. Lord, we pray your Spirit will give us life. As we look into the pages of Scriptures, we pray, Lord, life you will give unto us in Jesus' name. The grace to hear and to obey. And the grace, O God, to put into practice what you said, teach us, give unto every one of us in Jesus' name. We bless your name for your answer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's be seated. As you could see on the program, on our timetable, on the booklet, we are having the last message for the day, or possibly for the program, obedience and submission in the church. Obedience and submission in the church. If there is any topic that is very important, it is this. Let's open our Bibles to the book of 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 15. 1 Samuel chapter 15. I read verses 22 and 23. And Samuel said, "At the Lord has great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices, as in obeying the voice of the Lord. Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams." Verse 23. "For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry, because thou hast rejected the word of the Lord. He hath also rejected thee from being king." Look at the same chapter, 1 Samuel chapter 15. I read from verse 1. "Samuel also said unto Saul, The Lord sent me to anoint thee to be king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore, hearken thou unto the voice of the words of the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I remember that which Amalek did to Israel, how he laid wait for him in the way when he came up from Egypt. Verse 3. Now go," and that is instruction, "now go and smite the Amalek, and utterly destroy all that he hath, and spare them not, but slay both men and women, infant and serpent, oxen and sheep, camel and ass." So in this passage we see God spoke to Samuel, and he gave Samuel the instruction, and he was to pass the instruction unto Saul, which he did. And after the instruction God to the hands of Saul, he went to execute the order from God. But you know something? While he thought he has finished everything, he has executed the order, there was something that happened. Of course, he himself knew. He knew that he did not carry out the instruction given unto him by God through Samuel. He did not obey God in a complete way. And tonight we are talking about submission and obedience in the church. Actually, the two words, they are synonymous. You can use one. As I use one, you just think of the other. As I use the other, you just think of the first one. Submission is the same thing as obedience. They are synonymous one to the other. So this man Saul, he got the message from Samuel. Of course, Samuel was sent by God. And there we can learn a lesson. It is not only when God comes from heaven and appears to you that God is speaking to you. A lot of times, God sends your leader, either your immediate leader or a leader that is about far away from you, and he sends these leaders to you. We see the same thing in the passage we consider today in our study scriptures, that God did not talk directly unto the people of Israel. Actually, God spoke unto Moses. And God told Moses, go and gather the people of Israel. And then, before you gather them, make sure that Aaron is there. Pass the message unto Aaron. And the two of you together, go and gather the people. And make sure you have your rod in your hands. And then number three, make sure you speak unto the rod. Number one, gather the people. And number one, take your rod. Number two, discuss with Aaron and gather the people. Then number three, speak to the rod. So we see, Aaron and Moses got the information. And he gave it unto Aaron. And the two of them now, they pass it across to the people of Israel. The same picture we can see here, that the Lord spoke unto Samuel. And understand that some of us, I would say, I would have obeyed what he said. I know it's my leader. I would have obeyed what he said, but I'm going to wait until God of heaven speaks to me. Then I will do what he asked me to do. You are not behaving in accordance to the Bible. It is not all the time that God will speak directly unto you. You have a leader, and a lot of times in the wilderness, the Lord was speaking unto Moses. In fact, if you look through, most of the time he will give revelation to Moses, and from Moses it goes to Aaron, and then the two of them now, they pass it unto the people. So it is not only when God speaks to you that you say, well, now I can go to bed, now I can obey God. No, God can speak to your leader, and the people that God has appointed as leaders, that the people that God has said, these people are responsible directly to the leaders above them, and the leaders above them are responsible directly to another leader above them until he gets to God. And that is how God does his own things. And we need to understand, when we are talking of submission and obedience, don't waste your time. The leader that is above you as a colonial leader, obey him. The leader that is above you as an owner, obey him. The leader that is above you as a coordinator or as an executive, the leader that is above you, even as the body of executive together, obey those that are placed above you. Submission and obedience is needed in the church of God. Actually, the importance of obedience is beautifully captioned by that great reformer, Martin Luther, when he said, I had rather obey than work miracles. And you see, I had rather obey than work miracles. And the same thing is reflected in the passage that we have read. To obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of ram. To obey is better than service. To obey, if your leader tells you and gives you an instruction and you will not obey, the Bible is saying you are not even qualified to go on leaders kind of fellowship. If you will be instructed, you are told to do something, you are told, for instance, that well, tomorrow we are going to do something, and then you are not present, come here by 10 o'clock, we are going to get this thing done, and you are not present, and then while you are not present, you are doing another thing in the hall. Maybe you are praying and fasting for some people that are having some problems, and eventually your leader sees you and says, why is it that you don't come? Oh, you say, well, if I yesterday I would have come, but you know, there were things that were even more urgent than your instruction and your command and your call upon my life. There were some people that were having problem, and I need to solve the problem at that time. The word of God is saying, to obey is better than sacrifice. To obey the leader that God has placed over you is better than what you are doing in the hostel. You are wasting your time. God is not going to bless the labor of your hands, because you have an instruction and deliberately you say, well, I'm not going to listen to him. God has spoken to me. I should solve this problem now. Even though God has spoken to you, you still get back to your leader and let him release you before you eventually go and do that other thing. Why? Because to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken. From that word hearken, you see the word hear. To hear and to do is better than the fat of ram. Now, some people in the Old Testament, they didn't want to obey God. And so, do not want to obey leadership or obey God through the leadership. And the only thing they will go and be doing is to be sacrificing. It's like that man in the family who has offended his wife. And because he doesn't want, he finds it difficult to say, I'm sorry, my dear, I'm very sorry for what I did. And because of that, we go to the kitchen, we'll be washing all the plates, we'll be cooking when it's not supposed to cook, we'll be laying and sweeping the house so that the woman can say, thank you, daddy, and then the woman can be happy. Instead of coming down and say, I am sorry, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hurt him than the fat of ram. May God make us to obey in Jesus' name. In our present day, we see that there is a deflection from the right path towards independence and freedom. Every brother, every sister, every believer wants to be free. That I will do my own thing the way I am used to doing it. I will do everything I want to do the way I think it's best. And when a leader says, hold on, this is not how to do it, do it this way, oh, you say no. That is how you are used to doing it. But as far as I'm concerned, this is how I am used to doing it. No, in the church of God, it can never work like that. And then the leader comes to the house fellowship, and he sees the way you are leading the house fellowship, and he calls you after the end of the house fellowship and say, well, my brother, my sister, this is not how to do it. Do it this way, do it this way, do it this way, so that the name of the Lord can be glorified. And you smile. You say, my brother, you don't know the experience I've had before I even came here. If not for the fact that I came very late to the university, in fact, I should even be your leader. In fact, by now, I should be in part 5 in my program. And by now, I should even be even more than you, better than you. Because from the experience I have, this thing you are telling me, this is not how to do it. In fact, I would prefer to continue to do it the way I have learned, the way I have known, and this way I'm doing it. In fact, if you will listen, because I know you're a child of God, is even the best way to do it. To obey is better than sacrifice. Let's forget about this independence and this freedom. I would like to do it the way I want to do it. I would like to do it the way I have been brought up in Lagos. Even if you're in Lagos and you are born again in Lagos and you are born spiritually in Lagos and brought up spiritually in Lagos, and then you come here, hold on, there are some people that God has deliberately placed in place, put in place, and he wants them to be your leader. And once they are there for you, it is important for you to throw away this kind of independent spirit and throw away this kind of free spirit. I want to do the way I want. The Lord is still emphasizing the centrality of submission and obedience in his church. Do you know, if you are obedient, doors will be open for partnership. We'll be able to come together, be able to work together as partners, and be able to push forward and make the work of God to move forward. That means when there is obedience, when there is submission and obedience, there is partnership. When there is submission and obedience, there will be progress. When there is submission and obedience, there will be power. The power of the Lord will move in our midst. The work of the Lord will be saved and will be marching forward. When there is submission and obedience, there will be prosperity. When there is submission and obedience, that will be the powerful prayer. Because of submission, because of obedience, when we pray, our prayer will be powerful. When there's submission and obedience, that will be purity, because you are doing something. And leader calls you and say, my sister, it is not all you don't need to do it that way. The way you relate with brothers, this can be dangerous for you. And then you don't say, well, you don't know anything. In my family, in fact, all the people surrounding me, I have 11 children. My father has 11 children. So that means I have like 11 brothers and sisters. I am the 12th. And all the other people around me, in fact, I am the only sister among them. And at home, if you see us, in fact, you'll be amazed. We will normally have nice time. And because I'm used to brothers now, now that I come to campus, what are you now canceling me? What are you now telling me? In fact, I can sleep in the midst of the boys in a willow hall and nothing will happen. I know how to deal with them. I know how to push them around. So my sister, don't worry. My brother, don't worry. I know you are my leader. But there are some knowledge and some experiences that I've gathered in life that you have not gathered. Hold on. Stop this kind of independence. It is when we obey ourselves and we obey our leaders that there will be purity in our midst. What other thing do we have when there is obedience? When there is obedience, there will be peace. We'll not be fighting ourselves. Number one, when there's obedience, there'll be partnership. When there's obedience, number two, there'll be progress. When there's obedience, number three, there'll be power. When there's obedience, number four, there'll be prosperity. When there's obedience, number five, there'll be powerful prayer. When there's obedience, number six, there'll be purity. And in our midst, when there's obedience, there will be peace. I pray obedience will reign in our midst in Jesus' name. I want a better amen. Amen. I'm still not satisfied with the amen. Amen. We look at the message under three sub-edits. Number one, the first, the concept of submission and obedience. What is the idea all about? The concept of submission and obedience. Number two, cases of submission and obedience. Cases in the Bible. In our contemporary time, cases of submission and obedience. Then number three, caution in submission and obedience. Caution that we need to exercise in submission and obedience. Number one, the concept of submission and obedience. Deliberately, we are going to dwell longer on this first aspect, and the other aspect we dwell not for too long, but this first aspect we are deliberately going to spend longer time. The concept of submission and obedience. Look at the book of Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5. I read Ephesians chapter 5 verse 21. Submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of all. In the fear of all. If you are not answering me, I will tell all of you to stand up until I finish my message. To the fear of all. So you don't want to stand up. Praise the Lord. I know you have started it since morning and they're possibly tired, but this is also an important aspect of the program. Let's still be attentive and still learn from God. I pray God will help us in Jesus' name. I say God will help us in Jesus' name. I allow you, if you are tired and you are worn, you are sleepy, and you think you can't follow it on, I allow you to stand up any moment during the message so that you will not sleep and get the best from the Lord. Tonight, we'll get the best from God. So Ephesians chapter 5, I read verse 21 again. Submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. Thank you very much. In the fear of God. The meaning of that is this. I am submitting myself to my leaders, not because is just there by accident. I'm submitting myself to my leader simply because God has placed him there, and I fear God, and therefore I submit myself unto him just because of the fear of God that I have. But you understand, even in the Bible, this submission is not just from the leaders to the led alone. Submission goes beyond that. Look at the book of First Peter chapter 5. I read verse 5. First Peter chapter 5, verse 5. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. That's the first level. Second level, yea, all of you be subject one to another, and be clothed with humility, for God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. So we see in that passage the subject of submission, the subject of obedience, the subject of humility is for everybody. But we see God says, you that are younger, you need to submit unto them that are elder, that are leaders in the church. But not only that, even the leaders in the church cannot say, well, because I'm the leader, I can just do what I like with everybody. I can push everybody around. Even when God has not sent me, I can push everybody around. If God has not commanded me, I can disturb anybody. I can tell them to do anything because I'm the leader. No, the concept of obedience, of submission. As you are submitted and obedient unto the leader also is also submitted unto God. And not only that, even while he's passing across the information to you, while he's giving you the instruction, he is also submitted in a way. He is also humble in a way. And because of that, it is not just one or mono directional thing. It is a general thing for every one of us in the church of the living God. The New Testament refers to submission 41 times to let you understand how important submission is. The word of God God in the New Testament, we have it 41 times. And always in the context of relationship, number one, with God. Number two, with society. Number three, with other believers. As we see it in the New Testament, the subject of submission, which is referred to in the Bible, in relationship to our submission to God. Number two, our submission to the society, and then our submission to other believers. Let's start with the first one. Submission as it is yearly, that is has to do with God. We have to submit unto the Supreme. Unto the supreme being. We have to submit unto God. And in anything that happens in life, you must submit unto God. And in the book of Matthew chapter 6 verse 10, the word of God says, thy will be done. And God says, let me hear you. And that is the language of submission. That you are not expecting something negative, and eventually it happened. Then you look up unto God, you look up to heaven, and say, thy will be done. I read of a captain, a man of war, a great man of war. He was at the face of the battle with his son. And while they were fighting, the son was fighting very close to him. And right there, a bullet hit that child. And the grenade was so terrible that it cut off the head of the child from the body of the child. And the man looked at the lifeless body of his son right at the face of the battle, and he looked up unto God and he said, what did he say? Thy will be done. And that is somebody who understands submission. That is somebody who understands obedience unto God. And he says, Lord, I know I must be submissive unto the Supreme. And even though what has happened is contrary, even though what has happened is terrible, even though what has happened might have made other people to be speaking against God, but as far as I'm concerned, I have an obligation to be submissive unto the Supreme God. Therefore, though the things that has happened is horrible, yet, O Lord, thy will be done. So, our obedience is, our submission is, number one, unto the Supreme Being. Number two, unto the Savior. We still under God. Unto the Supreme. And number two, unto the Savior. Jesus Christ himself said in John chapter 14, verse 23, if ye love me, ye will keep my commandment. And that is the evidence if you love God. And evidence of submission unto God is that you keep the commandment of God. That means if you are not keeping the commandments of God, you are not submissive, you are not obedient unto God. Therefore, Christ Jesus himself said, anyone of you that is saying that he loves me must of a necessity do something as a sign of submission, as a sign of obedience. And that sign is, ye will keep my commandments. So number one, you are submissive to the Supreme. Number two, you are submissive to the Savior. Number three, you are submissive unto the Scriptures. In the book of Joshua chapter 1 verse 18, the Bible, verse 8, the Bible says, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth. Thou shalt read it day and night. And then you give yourself to the reading of the Bible simply because you know there's an instruction given unto you by God. Simply because you know these Scriptures is an eternal book. These Scriptures is not only here for this present time, but even in heaven, the pages of the Scriptures will be open. And because of that, you want to submit yourself to the Bible. You want to surrender yourself to the Bible. You want to read it day and night, so that at the end of the day, you will not be ashamed before God. So we see the Bible talks, the New Testament talks of submission 41 times in relationship to God, and then number two, to our society. When we are talking of society, we are talking of our nation. And the Bible makes us to understand in the book of Romans chapter 13 verse 1, let every soul be subject unto higher power. That's part of our submission. That's part of what we are called upon to do, that we are to be submissive unto the higher power in our nation, that we will so humble ourselves, we obey the law of the land. So far as the law of the land is not contrary to the word of God, we obey the law of the nation, we obey them that are above us, even in the nation, the governor, the president, we stand and we obey them in accordance to the word of God. Let every soul be subject unto higher powers. So not only that, when we are talking of society, we talk of nation and we talk of our neighbors. Remember, the word of God says, let your light shine so much unto the sea of good works, and they glorify your Father who is in heaven. And your neighbors around you, if they can't see the light of God in you, they will not glorify the Lord because of you. And how are they going to see the glory of God in you? By you being submissive unto them. Somebody in your neighborhood is having a problem, or he wants you to help him do something. Even though you are busy, yet you are submissive. And he says, well, can you please help me and assist me to do this thing, this other thing? Because you want the person to see the glory of God upon you. Or you don't say, well, normally every day, I read my Bible for 2 hours. And it's unfortunate for you that you came, I've just started, and I'm sorry, I have to finish reading the Bible. The next 2 hours, I can't come out to help you. I can come out. You submit yourself unto him, you assist him, you help him, and by so doing, the glory of God will be seen upon you, because part of our obedience and submission is not only to the Supreme, it's not only to the Savior, it's not only to the Scriptures, it's also to the nation and to our neighbors. And if you're in a foreign country, you need to submit also to the natives. You submit not only to your nation and to your neighbor, but even to the natives. You know, when you're in a foreign country, there are some things that you experience as a foreigner, and sometimes it's just as if you know you are carrying your screen everywhere, because the people, you are conscious of the people around you because you're a foreigner, and it's just as if the word foreigner is ringing into your ears every time. And because of that, sometimes if you are not careful, you can begin to behave in an abnormal way. And even the natives, when they talk to you, you can see what they are telling you as if maybe they are abusing you, or that maybe they are thinking it's because you are a foreigner that they are behaving like that. But the word of God says you have a responsibility unto the natives, that even if they are wicked, even if they are evil, even if they are rejecting you, even if they are saying bad things against you, wherever you may be, you still have to show to them that you are a child of God. This submission must still come to play. This obedience must still come to play, because it is by this obedience and this submission that they will see the glory of God upon you, and eventually they will give glory on your behalf. I pray that others will give glory on our behalf in Jesus' name. And then now, we said submission is a relationship with God, with the society, and now with other believers. When we are talking of other believers, we are talking of the family, and this is a family. And in the family, we have the priest, or you call him the pastor. We have the penitent, those that are just giving their lives unto Jesus Christ. And we have the people, those that are born again, maybe for some time now, and they are in the kingdom of God. The word of God says, we still need to submit one to the other. But understand, look at the book of Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. I read Philippians chapter 2 from verse 4. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. And in verse 9, you see the reward of obedience. the reward of humility, the reward of submission. God will always reward those that are submissive unto leadership. Sometimes it may be hard, but if you are submissive unto leadership, God does not joke with you. The blessing of God will come upon you. Look at that verse 9. Wherefore, God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, of the things in heaven, of the things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that word. Should confess what? So that is the profit of obedience. So we see in the family, the Lord is saying the priest, the penitent, and the people. The people should obey the priest, just as we say the laity should obey the leader. And of course, the leader is obeying God, and the leader also is subjected and obedient, and anything that can profit the church of God is ready to take even from the people. So we see this concept of submission and obedience is what the Lord is requesting from every one of us. I pray this thing that the Lord is requesting will give unto God even tonight in Jesus' name. Our obedience must possess the following qualities to make our obedience acceptable unto God. Brothers and sisters, maybe you are thinking you're obedient. I want you to test your obedience with the following qualities, with the following things. And by so doing, you'll be able to, your obedience will be acceptable unto God. And if you have not been obedient before, the Lord is saying tonight, make up your mind to be obedient. But not just ordinary obedience. Your obedience must be colored, must be tainted by the following things. Number one, your obedience must be complete. Look at the book of Numbers, chapter 20. Numbers, chapter 20. Numbers, chapter 20. I read from verse 8. Numbers, chapter 20. I read from verse 8. Take the Lord. Let's read this back up to verse 7. And the Lord spake unto Moses. You know, I told you, God spoke unto one man, the leader. And what did God tell him? And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, take the rod. Instruction number one. Take the rod. Instruction number two. And gather thou the assembly together, thou and Aaron thy brother. Now instruction number three. And speak unto the rock before their eyes. Those are the three instructions that God gave unto Moses. Number one, take the rod. Number two, gather the people, you and Aaron, and bring them. And then number three, speak to the rock before the people. Let's look at the obedience of Moses. We want to see this, or if it's complete or not. Look at verse 9. And Moses took the rod from before the Lord as he commanded him. Instruction number one, obedience to the first instruction. Brothers and sisters, can you see obedience to the first instruction there? I want an answer. Thank you very much. Let's go to verse 10. And Moses and Aaron gather the congregation together before the rock. As he obeyed the second instruction, thank you very much. Now let's go to the third one. Remember, the third one is speak to the rock. And now, and he said unto whom? Unto them. He didn't speak to the rock. God told him to speak to the rock. He spoke unto them, and he says, hear now, ye rebels, must we fetch you water out of the rock? And Moses lifted up his hand, and with his rod, he smote the rock. How many times? And the water came abundantly, and the congregation drank, and the beast also. You can learn a lot of things from what happened to Moses. You can learn a lot of things from the action of Moses. The Lord said, number one, take your rod. Number two, tell Aaron, you and Aaron, gather the people together. And then number three, speak to the rock. But Moses said, well, I've had what you said, Lord, but I will obey number one. I will obey number two, but number three, I will do the way I want. And then when he got to number three, he did not do it the way God wanted him to do it. And instead of speaking to the rock, he spoke unto the people. And while he was speaking to the people, he lifted up the rod and he hit the rock twice. Remember, he performed a miracle with the rod. And that is showing you the Lord cannot be stereotyped. God told him at a time, use the rock on the, use your rod on the rock and water will come out. But now the bee was thinking, I used the rod at a time. If I use it now, the water will still come. And then he wanted to stereotype God. And he did it the way the Lord has not commanded him. There was miracle, but this man Moses, the Lord said, you will not enter into that promised land. Think of the neighbor of Moses. Think of the servant of Moses. Think of the prayer of Moses. Think of the fasting of Moses. Think of the thing that Moses has experienced. In fact, the time they wanted to stone him. Despite that, remember, God is no respecter of person. We need to obey God completely. And if we do not obey God completely, no matter the position, no matter our experience, no matter the suffering in the kingdom of God, if you will not obey God completely, there will be a problem. There will be rejection. Look at that same verse, verse 11. And Moses lifted up his hand, and with the rod, he smote the rock twice, and the water came out how abundantly. And the congregation drank, and their cattle and their beasts also. Now look at verse 12. And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron, because you believed me not to sanctify me in the eyes of the children of Israel, therefore ye shall not bring the congregation into the land which I have given them. I pray that that negative pronouncement will not sound to any one of us on the day of judgment in Jesus' name. Therefore, our obedience must be complete. We must obey. Either we see the reason or not. Sometimes our leaders will give us instruction, and some of us will say, well, I'm not convinced yet. We want you to be convinced. We are praying for you to be convinced. The first month, I am not convinced yet. The second month, sir, I will be, but wait. But now, for now, I am not convinced yet. The whole of part one, I am not convinced yet. The whole of part two, first semester, I am not convinced yet. And at the end of part two, I am not convinced yet. A semester to your graduation, you are not convinced yet. How are you going to be convinced? There's no obedience in you. There's no submission in you. Understand, somebody that will obey, will obey. Either you see the reason to obey or not. Your role is just to obey. There's a leader ahead of you. There's a leader before you. And the leader says, this is what we want to do to move the church of God forward. Either you understand or not, obey Moses. Either you understand what God wants to do or not, obey Moses. Either you are provoked by the people or not, obey Moses. Either the people are wicked and terrible, obey. Our role is just to obey. Either you understand or not, our role is to obey. Are you man of God? Son, Samuel came to you and said, go and destroy the Amalekites. Remember, in this instance also, it was God speaking to Samuel, not directly to Saul. And God told Samuel, go and destroy the Amalekites. Go and tell Saul that. And he got to Saul and he told Saul. And eventually he went and did what he wanted. You just have to obey. Either you understand why Samuel said that or not. Don't begin to think of the history of Samuel. Don't begin to think of the experience of Samuel. Oh no, Samuel has given me this instruction simply because he grew up in the village. That's why he's talking like that. I know that other leader. That one grew up in the city. And if that one is going to talk to me, I know the way he's going to talk. I know he's going to give me that instruction in a different way. Let's go and try it. And then, higher leader has given you instruction. You went to another leader, and that leader also, because he doesn't know what the higher leader has told you, and he canceled you the way he thought is right. And then, when you see the conflict of instruction, then you are happy. And you talk it to another leader, you talk it to another leader, before you know it, all the leaders, you may even bring their heads together against the leaders in the church. Either you understand or not, obey the instruction given unto you. That is an evidence that you are a child of God. That is an evidence that you are going to heaven. That is an evidence that you understand what you are doing. That is an evidence that you have brought yourself under the control of the Almighty. Something happened here, in this same place several years ago while I was a student here. You know, I had a particular problem.
And I came to my leader. I didn't understand what was happening to me. And then I came to that leader. And then when I discussed my problem with the leader said, ah, this is a serious problem. And then he told me what to do. Do this way, do this way, do this way. And then, myself also, ready to obey at all times. What is my leader? I'm telling you, sometimes when your leader is wrong, obey. God knows how to bring you to the right path. And even while it's wrong that you're obeying, God knows how to bring positive things out of that negative thing. What I mean by that is this. If your leader is wrong, he's not saying it because he knows he himself is wrong. He's saying it based on the conviction that he's having at that time. And he tells you, go ahead and obey him. And if there's anything that is wrong, God knows how to change that mistake to a design. Our role is just to obey. And what my leader told me to do, I went ahead and I did it. I did it when he said it. It was later in life I understood. The instruction the leader gave me was wrong. But you know something? God blessed me. And the blessing that God gave unto me for obeying him, even the wrong instruction he gave unto me, I'm telling you, that blessing is still in my life till today. And my family is enjoying it. My wife is enjoying it. She's hearing me. She's enjoying that blessing that God gave unto me simply because of that obedience to the wrong counsel of the leader. Brothers and sisters, if the church of God is going to move forward, we must obey. If we are going to enjoy blessings of the Lord, we must obey. Either we see the reason or not. Remember, it is God that knows the best. And God that knows the best has put in there the grace to obey. God will give unto us in Jesus' name. And understand, this obedience must be complete. You know, in our church today in the road, somebody asked a question during the question and answer at Sunday time. And the person says, the leader that taught us was talking about the, you know, jelly coiling and the panning and all that. And she was very sincere, and that's why I answered the question also sincerely. And he said, she said, well, which one is not good? Because she talked about, you know, jelly coiling, using this kind of hot comb to do your hair, to relax the hair and all that. And then he said, but there are so many people in other churches and they are very deep spiritually and they are still doing this thing. They are still jelly coiling and they are stretching their hair and all that, using hot comb. He said, which one do we do? And I told the individual, come back to the Bible. There's no place you can show me in the Bible where the wife of Peter or James or John relax their hair, or they remove the color of their skin, or they put a long nose and they are dangling it everywhere, and they painted it red, the hand, the fingers are red, the lips are red, and then the eyelashes are red. And he said, why is it that you put red everywhere like this? And he says, the blood of Jesus. What kind of blood of Jesus? You know, we need to obey. And if you have been telling us about all these things, relaxing here, looking more like the world, and button down and all that, you say you are not convinced, and then you waste all the time, and we pray and pray, the leadership prayed and fasted, and then went to the place of prayer, and we come back to you, we say, well, you can be useful, you can drop all these worldly things, empty we came, empty we are going to go, why don't you drop this thing and dress like the Israelites of God, and do something for the Lord? Oh, you say, yes, I'm not convinced, I want to look wonderful. If you want to look wonderful like that, you cannot be useful for God. Let your obedience be complete. And then when we say, don't wear this kind of dress, don't do this other thing, because we do not edify anybody, don't wear this kind of shoes that you wear, and when you are walking, everybody is turning and looking at you, and everything is doing pa, 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 everywhere you go. And we say, a Christian, if there's anything, if there is preaching of the gospel, let me tell you something. If I will wear a shoe, and while I'm going, the thing is making noise, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And I take another step, except a man be born again, he cannot wait to get to the kingdom of God. And I take another step, and he says, give your life to Jesus Christ, I will be one of those people that will buy that thing and wear it. But this pa, 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 and everybody's looking and turning and looking at you, looking at the beauty, looking at the thing, and distracting people. Why do you need to continue to do that? Why do you need us to open Bible to you before you know that this thing is wrong? Let your obedience be complete. What do I mean by that? You don't wear them to the church and you don't have them in your wardrobe. That is a complete obedience. You don't wear them in the church and you don't wear them to the lecture. You don't wear them to the church, and you don't wear them when you go on vacation. That is the complete obedience I'm talking about. That you put all your shoes that are making noise, you put them in a cupboard in a particular place, and when you go on vacation, you put them on. You put all your clothes that we have told you that you expose your body and makes another person to be thinking of immorality. You put them in a particular place. You say, these people, don't worry. When I go on vacation, I will enjoy myself. And the day you are able to get home, you put them on and you look for one photographer, sorry, please just be taking me. Because you just enjoy wearing those things. What is all that? Let your obedience be complete. And God will bless you in Jesus' name. Number one is to be complete. Number two, the obedience must be cheerful. For God loveth a cheerful giver. God love it. A cheerful giver. Give that thing unto God. Say to God, because I want to serve, because I love you. I'm not giving up because the GCs say I should give it up. I'm not giving it up because the hall up says I should give it up. I'm not giving up because my house carrying fellowship leader says I should give it up. I'm not giving up because a respected person in the church says I should give it up. I'm giving it up because of the love that I have for Jesus Christ. And because of the passion I have for the kingdom of God. Therefore, I give it up. And as you are giving up, you are saying, Lord, I bless you for this grace. And sometimes you are giving up some things. Even though it may cause you some pain, yet you give it up. Let it be given up cheerfully. And remember the word of God that says, be not unequally yoked together with unbeliever. What fellowship has righteousness in your righteousness? And here you are, maybe you have one way or the other put yourself in a trap. I don't expect anyone of us to be like that, but I will still make my illustration. Maybe you have trapped yourself with a particular man somewhere. And then you are hearing the word of God. And then the Lord is challenging you and say, this man is an unbeliever. Give him up. And then you give him up and you are still thinking, if not for our church now, this man would have helped me in this my problem. If not for our church now, this problem I'm having, this man would have sent credit to me, he would have sent money to me, he would have done this. No, you give him all and you do it out. You do it how? You do it cheerfully. And that is the kind of obedience that the Lord is expecting from us. Also, it must be consistent. You do it now and you do it later. You do it now and you do it later. It's not every time we'll be challenging you and saying, yeah, wake up now, do it, and then for 1 week we will obey. And then the second week we'll go back to the wrong thing. No! Immediately you are challenged by the word of God. Give these things up. Let it be a consistent obedience. At the time our pastor talked about brothers fooling sisters in the night and sisters fooling brothers in the night, I do not know how many people are obedient to that. And while the pastor was saying, somebody came to me and said, Pastor, you know, because we have just been taught, it will still carry us for some weeks. But after some weeks, I know, the person was saying it, some people will relax, they will lapse, and will go back into that thing. That is not an acceptable obedience. That is not an obedience that is honored and respected and blessed by God. Why are you following sisters in the night? What do you want to take from them in the night? Why are you following brothers in the night? What do you want to take from them in the night? It is true, it is free. The fire that is free must not be destroyed because something is free. Therefore, if you have been challenged once about it, take that conviction, be sure, and throw it away. Throw away what is wrong, throw away what is evil, and do it in a consistent way. What a way we told you to come early to the house of the Lord. And then maybe there's a message on coming early, commitment, consecration, and everybody prayed the first week, we all came very early. Apart from people that has gone to invite people and all that, even those that have gone to invite people, they went early enough, and eventually they brought the people and they are there, and everybody's enjoying the service 2 weeks later. Late coming started again. It's not supposed to be like that. If you are challenged to come early, if the leader challenges you to come early, in fact, the word of God challenges you that God is waiting for you and be there. Don't allow God to be waiting for you. You should be the one that will be waiting for God. And immediately you hear that kind of a message, don't just let it work on you just for 2 weeks or 3 weeks. And eventually the whole church at the end of the day goes back to the former evil way. It's not supposed to be. Our obedience must be consistent. When you are coming to church, you are challenged, invite somebody with you. And then when you are challenged, you are inviting people, all of a sudden you just slump back and go back even to the former way. No, our obedience must be consistent. I pray the grace to make our obedience consistent, the Lord will give unto us in Jesus' name. That's not the end of it. Remember, number one, obedience must be complete. Number two, it must be cheerful. Number three, it must be consistent. Now, second part of the qualities of our obedience. Number one, it must be prompt. It must be point. There were two people that Jesus Christ met, and when he met them, he said, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." The Bible says they were prompt in their obedience. Open your Bibles to the book of Matthew, chapter 4. Matthew, chapter 4. I read Matthew, chapter 4, verses 19 and 20. Matthew, chapter 4, verses 19 and 20. "And he said unto them, Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And they straightway left their nets, and did what? And did what everybody? And followed him." Our obedience must be prompt. When you are told to do something, don't wait next year. Before you do it, that kind of obedience will not be blessed by God. But when you are called upon to do something, then do it immediately. I want to challenge you with a soldier. I read the story of a soldier. This soldier, after they were fighting battle, and eventually they brought themselves together. And then the leader said, the captain said, "Who among the soldier is the best soldier?" And this person will say, "I have something to say. The one that has killed so many people and destroyed and done this and captured this place and captured that other place, that is the best soldier." Another person will rise up and say, "The one that has done this and done this, that is the best soldier. And this other person is the best soldier." But eventually, the leader says, "All of you are wrong. I saw one soldier, and that soldier is the best soldier." Do you know what the soldier did while they were fighting? Actually, he lifted up his weapon. He lifted up his instrument to kill an enemy. And while he lifted up the instrument to kill the enemy, the trumpet sounded, or sound from the leader. You know, the trumpet of "Stop fighting." And immediately he heard the trumpet. The hand that he lifted up, that trumpet that he had, he refused to kill the enemy. He lifted up the trumpet and the hand yet, and he let the enemy go. What is the meaning of that? He didn't strike the enemy. And the captain said, that obedience is a prompt obedience. He had it, and he didn't say, "So many soldiers would have done well. This one is already in my hand. Let me finish this one, and after I finish this one, I can now go and join them, and then we'll rejoice together because the battle is over." But right there, while he lifted up his hand to strike the enemy, the trumpet sound, and he did not strike that enemy. That is the illustration of a prompt obedience. And the Lord is expecting it from you, and the Lord is expecting it from every one of us. Our obedience to leadership must be prompt. Whenever you are told, you go and do it. Let's go to this other place and evangelize. On Tuesday, we are going to be there, and everybody gathers together, and then we go. On Wednesday, we are going to this other place. Everybody is there, and we go. And this other day, we are going to this other place. Everybody is there, we are going to do it. And then we say house fellowship immediately after this other thing. We are going to do house fellowship. Every house carry fellowship leader. Make sure you gather. You don't say, "Well, gather for where?" I'm hungry. Go to the hotel, eat, and then I come back. When you see me, I will say sorry. That's not prompt. Even though you are hungry and you are almost dying, your leader says, "Wait. Why don't you go and see me if you can't cope?" I say, "I'm almost falling down. If you don't release me, I may even collapse." And then the leader will organize how you can get water and biscuit for you here, and then you could leave it behind the thing there, and then you join us. And if you're so serious, then the leader also is not a wicked person, he will release you. But while taking loss into your heart, wait every worker, and then you say, "Well, they won't know that I've gone." And then you just go like that. What of the instruction to stop switching on your phone in the church? Workers. And then you won't switch it on. But you are switching it on. You are not completely disobeying, but also not completely obeying. You put it on vibration, and then you put it by your side. And when your mommy falls, you do like this. Your daddy falls, you do like this. Your auntie falls, you do like this. And after the service, all the people that fall, you begin to flash them. Why don't you pick the phone? They don't even know who you are. You don't allow them to know who you are. "Oh, mommy, I'm sorry, I was in the church. Daddy, I'm sorry, I was in the church. Auntie, I'm sorry, I'm in the church. Uncle, I'm sorry, I'm in the church." What is the meaning of that? Switch off that phone. Let all of them be trying and trying and trying. And eventually when they tried and tried on a Sunday and they didn't get you, and eventually on Monday they said, what happened to you? Where did you put your phone? Oh, sorry, I was in the presence of the Lord. And this other person's phone, sorry, I was in the presence of the Lord. By so doing, they receive your good works and give glory unto your Father who is in heaven. There were times that we did not have phone and we were still surviving. How come that the phone will now be our controller? Let your obedience be prompt. And as I'm saying it, if you have been doing it, do it no more. And God will bless you in Jesus' name. I want a better amen. Our obedience number one must be prompt. And then number two, it must be plunter. I will explain to you what I mean by that. There are some children in the Bible, the children of the Rechabites. We call them the Rechabites. The father gave them instruction, do not drink wine. And even after the death of their parent, of their father, the man of God brought them to the temple and said, enjoy yourself, drink, and just have a nice time. Your father, he didn't say that, but of course, their father was already in the grave. And he said, no, our father told us something. That's a parental obedience. Now, your parents told you, your father's in the Lord, your mother's in the Lord, here. Or possibly, maybe your parents are converted and they're children of God. And they told you things that are biblical and spiritual. Even though you are not with them, you are still demonstrating this parental obedience. That they were not there, or they are there, you still want to maintain it. My father in the Lord told me, my mother in the Lord told me, my brother in the Lord told me, my sister in the Lord told me. This parental affectionate obedience is very important. And I read of the story of a young lady, of a young boy, I think a boy or a girl, I can't remember now. He was playing with his other friends, and while they were playing, rain was coming down, and the boy said, I have to leave now. And they said, why do you want to leave? My mother has told me not to play under the rain. Two or three people talk at the same time and say, what is your body? What's the difference between your body and our body? If the rain falls on you, it's also going to fall on us. What is the difference? And the child said, I will not disobey my mother for any of you. That's a parental obedience. That's a parental obedience. You know that what your mother, your father, your parents in the church have said is righteous. And somebody wants to dissuade you, or somebody wants to convince you. A group of people are gathering together in the church to divert your attention from what is right. When you say, no, I will not obey, I will not disobey my mother, I will not disobey my father, I will not disobey my leader because of you. Where are you just coming from? I won't disobey my leaders because of you. No way. That is the parental obedience we are talking about. I pray the Rechabites will not stand against us on the day of judgment in Jesus' name. Even though the parents was dead, yet they are obedient. How much more the parents that are alive? And not only that, number one, it must be prompt. Number two, it must be parental. And number three, it must sometimes be painful. It can be painful sometimes. I will not give unto the Lord that which costeth me nothing. That you give that obedience unto God. That even in your heart of heart, you will say, even not because I love the Lord. And while you are saying that, tears are rolling down your cheeks. And you say, even not because I love the Lord. Nobody could have persuaded me to do this. Nobody could have even forced me to obey this. Nobody could have brought me to this. Even not because I love the Lord. And while you are saying that, you are crying, but the spirit of the Lord in you, but the heart of joy in you, you are still joy. And you are still happy, and you are saying, I am giving this unto the Lord. It is painful, but I will give it unto the Lord. That is the kind of obedience that will give joy, that will give you blessing. I remember a brother now, many years ago, the wife was with us in Germany. And the brother is a man of God, a preacher, a minister in the Church of God in Nigeria here. At the time, we know the time of Abacha, some of you may not know very well, but I know most of us will know also. The very difficult time, Abacha time, very difficult time, economically, politically, everything was just upside down. The wife was in Germany, and the brother got visa to come to Germany to come and join the wife. And when he got the visa, we were happy over there. Oh, he's coming. It's just as if he's going to leave that jungle and come and join the wife now. Everything is going to be wonderful. And he himself is happy. Everybody is happy with the woman over there. And we are happy and all that. But remember, the brother was serving with deeper line. And he said, before I go, he had the visa. And he said, before I go, I must see my father in the Lord, the general superintendent. So he went to Lagos, and then he saw the general superintendent, sir, I'm on my way to Germany. I just say I should see you before I go. The GS said, you are going nowhere. And then the brother followed us, thank you, sir. Of course, Thank you, sir. In his heart, the will be done. The brother phoned us, I've been to the GS. He said, I'm going nowhere. Tell my wife to pack her things and do what? And come down. Today, this brother I'm talking about is one of the state overseers in Nigeria. Praise the Lord. To obey is better than sacrifice, and to hear him than the fat of lamb. While your obedience may be painful, but yet make sure you obey, and God will bless you for it in Jesus' name. And then another level of qualities now, our obedience must be exact. It must not change. You must not deviate. It must be exact. If you are told to spend 15 minutes for asking fellowship of a message, make sure you spend 15 minutes. If you are told to preach an outline, don't go and introduce something that is strange to that outline. Remain with the outline. If you are told to do one thing or the other, remain with the instruction. If you want to change it, just discuss with the leader, what about if I had this, and I had this, and I had this other thing, and the leader will agree with you if it is biblical and acceptable and proper. But for you to just go and say in your heart, I'm going to change this thing, I'm going to do the way I know. No, that would be contrary to the word of God and to the concept of obedience to leadership. The obedience must be exact. Not only that, the obedience must be explicit. It must be explicit. I explained that to you by the story of a young lady. The father was a fireman. You know, these people that quench fire everywhere. And from the experience of the father knew when there is a fire outbreak, especially in a place where there are so many people, the formula is this: sit where you are. And that is the safest method. That you don't just, because normally when there is fire outbreak in a place where there are so many people, all of them want to rise up at the same time. And no matter how big the door may be, it will not accommodate all of them. And while they are struggling, you want to go out first, I want to go out first. In fact, the fire can even destroy all of them there. The father told this little girl, if there is fire outbreak in your school, make sure you maintain your position. And funny enough, that thing happened to that girl. There was fire outbreak in the school, and everybody was running. I mean, every student running here and there, running helter skelter, running looking for the door, running looking for where to go out. And the child saw the fire. But the child remembered in the instruction of his father, and that child sat in that same position. And there was a teacher who saw the child. The teacher saw the other people running helter skelter, and he saw the child sitting and maintaining her position. Eventually, the teacher went to the child and said, "What happened? How come you are sitting in the midst of turbulence? Now you are sitting peacefully like that?" He said, "My father is a fireman. And my father told me the best way to escape being destroyed in a fire outbreak is when the fire is burning like that, at least initially, you maintain a peaceful atmosphere." And he says, "Even though I was terribly afraid within me, yet the instruction of my father, I head on unto it." Sometimes we told you to obey. Sometimes the obedience, you may just be frightened by some circumstances. You may be frightened by some situation, but make your obedience explicit. Like the obedience of this young lady. Now, even though the fire was there and the fire brought fear into her heart, yet she obeyed her father. You obey your father. You obey God your father, and you obey your fathers in the Lord in Jesus' name. So obedience must be exact, it must be explicit, and it must be educative. It must educate others. Your obedience must be a challenge to others, that others will see you obey and they will give glory unto God. This will be our experience in this church in Jesus' name. Our time is fast spent, but I go to cases of submission and obedience. And I just have some people in the word of God that obey the law. Of course, you know them. Abraham obeyed the law. Take your son, your only son, go and sacrifice him unto me on that particular month that I am going to show to you. He had the voice of the Lord. He obeyed without problem, and he went and did the same. What of Noah? Build an ark for me. Noah did did the same. What of Jesus? Of course, we have read of Jesus. He brought himself low. In fact, in the form, he became like a servant who had no sin, and he subjected himself to the will of God. What of Paul the Apostle? I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision. This is the vision that has been given unto me. I have no option now. I have been persecuting the church before, but the vision has been given unto me. And right from this moment, once the vision has been given unto me, I have no option but to be obedient unto the heavenly vision. And these are the people in the word of God that have obeyed God, and it was well with them. If you obey God, it will be well with you. There is a man, a commander of the ship of war. The ship of war is called Orient. And this commander had a son. The name of the son is Casabianca. Not Casablanca, but Casabianca. And this man was on the warship with his son. And the son was also a soldier, a military man on the sea. And this man gave an instruction unto his son. He gave him a duty post. And he told him, stand here. And the man stood there shortly after the instruction, and of course he understood, until my father relieved me from this position, I can't go anywhere. Shortly after that, the father died, and the son didn't know, Casabianca did not know, that the father had died. And the war was very terrible, and the battle was very fierce, and the grenade and the bullets were hitting the ship, and even saw other sailors jumping out and escaping for their life. In fact, their own boat or ship has caught fire. And the child said, Father, can I go? And didn't hear the voice of his father. But because he didn't hear his father to release him, he stood there, he remained firm at his post, and perished in the flames. That is somebody who is committed to his father, who was a soldier. The Lord is saying, our obedience will be more than that. Our obedience will be more than that of ordinary man that is just respecting his father because his father was a captain. Our father in heaven is greater than the captains of all the world put together. And our leaders in the church are better than the captains of the world. Let us obey them, and God will bless us mightily in Jesus' name. Finally, we come to caution in submission and obedience. Open your Bibles to the book of Acts, chapter 5. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 5. I read Acts chapter 5, I read verse 29. Acts chapter 5, verse 29. Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. Everybody read it, let me hear your voice. Let's say it again, everybody. Let's say it, everybody. Say it again. Make sure you are saying it. We ought to obey God rather than men. Brothers and sisters, there is caution in submission. What do you mean by that? The limits of submission are at the point where submission becomes destructive. When submission becomes destructive, then that is the limit of submission. Or you do not go on and keep on obeying. And then you keep on saying, well, no matter what happens, I'm a child of God. I cannot fight anybody. I cannot do anything contrary. I cannot wound anybody. And then danger to defile your life and destroy your Christian life is approaching you, and say, no, I cannot say anything harsh against this individual. He's also a child of God. If I say anything wrong now, even though we have been instructed not to phone ourselves in the night, this person is not phoning me. If I talk very harsh to this person, he's a child of God, God will not be happy with me. No, when obedience gets to a point, it can destroy you. Then, at that moment, you need no more to obey. Church, do we understand? Only few people answered my question. Do we understand? Peter called the old church to obey the governors. Peter called the old church to obey those that are in authority. Peter called the old brethren to obey those that are placed above them. But when it came to the issue of disobedience may affect our stand in the law. Disobedience may affect our evangelism. Peter says, no way. We ought to obey God rather than men. That means when obedience gets to the point that it can destroy your spiritual virtue, when obedience gets to the point that it can destroy your testimony, when obedience gets to the point that it can destroy the things that you have been laboring for and the things that you have been preserving, the holiness, the righteousness, the purity, and the good testimonies that you want to have, and that obedience at that particular time wants to lead you to destroy those virtues, then you say, no, obedience has stopped. And at that time, you rise up with boldness of the law, and you rise up with boldness of the believer. You rise up as somebody that has the Bible, and even as a disciple of Jesus Christ, you refuse boldly. Listen, sometimes not arrogantly, but in the spirit of meekness. May the Lord help us to obey in Jesus' name. I want to rise up on our feet and talk to the Lord that as the Lord has called into his kingdom, you will not be a bastard. You will be an obedient child of God. You will love the Lord. You will obey leadership. You will obey authority. You will be submissive. Remember, obedience will make our church to grow. Obedience will lead to partnership. Obedience will lead to progress. Obedience will lead to power. Obedience will lead to prosperity. Obedience will make our prayer to be powerful. Obedience will lead to purity. There will be peace when we obey and if we obey. Tell the Lord, give me grace, O Lord, to obey. Help me, Lord, to obey. Assist me, Lord, to obey. Open your mouth and call upon the name of the Lord. What are the clothes you are wearing that will not give glory to God? Throw them away by another set. What kind of shoes are you wearing that will not give glory to God? Throw them away by another set. What kind of attitude are you putting on that will not give glory to God? Throw those attitudes away and put on another better biblical attitude. Why don't you call upon the name of the Lord? I will obey. O Lord, give me grace to obey. To obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of the ram. All your sacrifices will be in vain if you are not obeying. All your labors will be in vain if you are not obeying. All our prayers and labor and effort will be in vain if we refuse to obey our leaders and obey God through them. Why don't you call upon the name of the Lord? Oh Lord, you will help me. My obedience will be complete. My obedience will be sincere. My obedience will be even prompt. Open your mouth and call upon the name of the Lord. That the Lord of heaven, he will help you in the name of Jesus. And my obedience will be cheerful. My obedience will be consistent. My obedience will be prompt and prompter. My obedience will, even though it may be painful, yet I will obey the Lord. My obedience will be exact and explicit. My obedience, I will make sure it is educative, blessing other people, educating other people, challenging other people, encouraging other people. Ask the Lord to help you. The Lord is calling every one of us tonight to obedience. Both young and old, the Lord is calling us. Among ourselves, we love ourselves and we obey ourselves and submit to ourselves. And even in the church, we obey ourselves and submit ourselves to ourselves. And then, as leadership, we obey and we obey leadership so that the work of the Lord can prosper. Open your mouth and call upon the name of the Lord. This is the demand of God upon your life at a time like this. Open your mouth and call upon the name of the Lord. Just as God rose on high, spoke to men in days gone by, so the Lord is calling men today, and my brother, this is true. Whatsoever he says to you, there's but one thing to do. Just obey. Open your mouth, pray unto the Lord to help you to obey. Just obey. Just obey is the way God's way. When his message comes to you, there is but one thing to do. Just obey. Just obey. Ask the Lord to help you. And I can assure you tonight, as you pray sincerely to God, you will get grace from the Lord. You will obey the Lord. You will obey leadership. You will obey the people of God. Open your mouth and call upon the name of the Lord for your life. This obedience will take you to heaven. Disobedience will take your name away from the book of life. And obedience will make you more effective in the kingdom of God. Pray unto your God tonight.